Boy, I had a relaxing 2023. Geopolitically, everything was great. All of the food I wanted still cost normal prices. And boy, oh boy, this music. There was actually a lot of good music. And I decided to do another top 10 list against my own best judgment. But I decided to do something different for this. Instead of doing one big video that covers the 10 albums that I want to talk about, I'm going to talk about each one of them separately in smaller videos and release them over the course of the beginning of 2024. I imagine that this project will still take me a while, but hopefully not until November this time. So stay tuned if you want more, and if you don't, then here's just this one video about Lil Yachty. So what is that intangible quality that has made Lil Yachty as intriguing of an artist as he is? In 2016, his debut mixtape, Lil Boat, essentially primed the pipes for a second wave of clout rap to take over, and he basically did enough in that year alone to become a permanent figurehead that was written into whatever this next chapter of hip-hop was going to be. But once that page actually turned, it felt like he lost his lead pretty quickly. While that mixtape turned a lot of heads, his style wasn't really mature enough to develop a die-hard loyal fanbase, and just one year later, he would release his disastrous major label debut, Teenage Emotions, to middling reviews and a lot of negative buzz on the internet. What initially came across as a mysterious musical nomad paddling his own path on a crystal lake now came across as an untrained kid being put in charge of a commercial ship trying to Tokyo drift through the Suez Canal. The highly produced sound wasn't really the best backing for his more amateur sensibilities, and his attempts at portraying a sort of teenage euphoria didn't come across as serious, with lines like, "Damn boat, you hella wild, turn your mother to a pedophile," and of course the eternal, "My new bitch yellow, she blow that dick like a cello." Of course, later on explaining that he thought a cello was the thing that Squidward played. Yachty's specific brand of being a punk always seemed to come across more in him being an absent-minded goofball, and his attempts at being sleeker and darker with his sound always fell a little flat for me. I felt like the main appeal of the initial Lil Boat mixtape was you could tell he was having a lot of fun making it, playing these goofy characters and just spitting whatever the fuck he wanted over these minimalist, silly beats. So I think that's kind of what tanked his initial momentum. And ever since then, he's been sticking around. I don't feel people have lost interest in him, but the four releases he put out since then felt more like they were riding waves than actually making them. Even with his novelty hit Poland this year, it felt like just him trying to get in on rage music. So going into 2023, I wouldn't blame you if you thought the Lil Yachty moment was over. He's still a curious artist, but he's been sort of stagnant. This guy's never gonna radically alter his sound and completely eclipse all of his contemporaries. Now. So yeah, if you didn't hear, Lil Yachty came through right at the beginning of this year with a full-fledged psychedelic rock album, like instrumentals mostly consisting of real guitars, real drums, synthesizers, and barely any rapping from Mr. Yacht himself. Again, it was a really bold artistic move that turned a lot of heads, and while the reception to this album seemed a little lukewarm, after a full year of listening to it, I can honestly say I love it. Even more than like most mainstream rock releases I've heard this year. There's something about Yachty's position as an outsider that makes him just experiment even more, that leads to really interesting song structures that just pack in progression after progression and just follows that wherever the song takes it. Like the opener, The Black Seminole, which has a tempo change, two huge dynamic swells, a vocal solo, a guitar solo, a drum solo, all happening in tandem with one another. And that establishes the general theme of this album, which is just letting things happen, letting the pen hit the paper and seeing where it goes. This gets outlined more clearly later with a sample of a Bob Ross clip.
Just let your imagination run wild. Let your heart be your guide. In the time you sit around worrying about it and trying to plan a painting, you could have completed a painting already. Let it happen. Let it happen.
And yeah, while I think there are some things on this album that come across as philosophically a bit vacuous, I don't think Lil Yachty is necessarily a deep thinker, but there's a charming simplicity to this message, and the album definitely fleshes it out in a really fulfilling way. This album deals thematically in moments of euphoria and our pursuit of them as human beings, wrapping discussions of spiritual completeness into songs about falling in love or just feeling yourself in any given moment. The songs Running Out of Time and Say Something have a quality of angst to them about, you know, when will these things finally be achieved? And the euphoria itself is given a pretty nice metaphor in the idea of seeing the sun being referenced as like reaching nirvana or having some sort of revelation. It fits into the psychedelic rock sound really well. And Yachty is by no means working alone on this one. There's a whole slew of collaborators here being brought on to help fulfill his vision. Tizo Touchdown has a verse, Daniel Caesar has a verse, one of the guys from MGMT helped on the production, as did Magdalena Bay. Mac DeMarco and Alex G lent an instrumental to the interlude where Yachty talks about failure. And also Tory Lanez. Which, you know, that kind of ruins it for me. But it is on, like, the most skippable song on the album. But definitely one of the collaborators that brings the most to the album is Diana Gordon, a vocalist that he uses for the songs Black Seminole, Drive Me Crazy, and I've Officially Lost Vision. Drive Me Crazy, to me, being the centerpiece of this album, probably the best song that Lil Yachty's ever written. It's a full-on disco cut, complete with, like, a string section, and her vocals on the first verse and the chorus are extremely pristine. It's one of those songs that has like an extremely catchy hook that it only uses once in the entire song, which I love that as like a musical power move. Like, yeah, you want to listen to this again? Go replay the song, fucking idiot. Give me more streams. But on top of that, the progression just works really well into like one of Yachty's only rap verses on the album at the end, where things sort of quiet down and get more airy. The song itself is sort of a spiritual love song based off of the idea of like predestined and two people always being meant to be together, which I think, on top of being just like a sweet message, plays thematically really well into this whole psychedelic experience of an album. To me, this song seems like it's trying to explore the same sweetness and vitality that Teenage Emotions was, but just realized at like such a deeper level. This song actually portrays the idea of being young and falling in love as this like mystical thing. And I feel like that is achieved through, again, Yachty just having fun with the music that he's making, and also being unorthodox enough to just completely experiment like this. And I like how he's using disco and psychedelic rock as influences here. Like, you know, the main image of psychedelic rock right now is kind of just a bunch of white guys. And while it doesn't need to be a race thing, it's a good jumping off point to talk about, you know, George Clinton or Jimi Hendrix or Sly Stone or any number of black artists who were extremely influential on psychedelic rock as we know it today. Yachty and his backing band being the biggest representation of that in the mainstream this year felt like it could open up those conversations again and change the image of psychedelia as it stands in pop music right now, which this year kind of fell flat for me. I think that's kind of what makes Let's Start Here so good, is kind of how against the meta it goes for rap artists. Like, outside of the wavy, despondent psychedelia and the rage music that Uzi and Kart and Yeet are making, you know, Yachty's coming across with stuff that is actually emotionally depthful and portrays a serious sense of, like, spirituality. And fuck, isn't that what makes psychedelic music great? You know, I look at a song like Uzi Vert's Just Wanna Rock, and instead of being freeing and energizing, it feels like it's totally just caught in the trappings of the mainstream sound right now. And for rocking out, it feels like this song is happening entirely in the background. It just feels like 2 minutes of getting edged. It's like the Lonely Island When Will the Bass Drop skit. But Yachty circumvents this entirely by bringing in a ton of emotion and just building these songs with huge progressions, having these soaring guitars, and working that into his own style very well. His auto-tuned and spooky vibrato kind of feels completely at home in this genre. And I feel it comes as a lesson for mainstream artists to just not paint themselves into a corner and be welcoming to new ideas wherever they may come from. Witnessing this whole moment for Yachty was super euphoric. And I think that answers the initial question. Why is Lil Yachty so intriguing? Well, It's because he can pull out something like this at a moment's notice. He really follows his own path, and man, was this album a rewarding destination. So yeah, this is kicking off my discussion of my favorite albums of the year. Hope you enjoy. Subscribe and stay tuned for newer videos. I'm getting messages. I'm so popular. Links to the album in the description. Go have fun.